You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI Show, where we take Azure Search to the next level with something called Knowledge Store. Make sure you tune in. Hello and welcome to this episode of the AI Show. I've got a special guest. We're going to talk about search, but a special kind. Tell us who you are and what you do, my friend.
Hi, I'm Vinod Karpat. I'm a Principal Program Manager on the Applied AI team, and I work on Azure Search.
Fantastic. So tell us about Azure Search real quickly for those that don't know, and then let's talk about how AI is making it better.
Great. So Azure Search is a search as a service. So essentially, you know, when you think about search, there's a number of different ways that you could use search. You use SharePoint Search, for example. But Azure Search gives you all the rich controls that you'd need to build a custom search experience. So things from custom analyzers to custom ranking, custom scoring profiles. So you can build a search experience that matches exactly what you want to provide for your end customers. And that's sort of the overall product capability.
Got it. So I've heard of something called cognitive search. Is that the same thing? Is it a different thing? Or is it all the same thing? We just need to understand a little better.
Yeah, absolutely. Cognitive search is essentially a feature within Azure Search that allows you to enrich your data using AI skills as you're moving the data from your data source into your index. So think about things like one of the examples that I'm going to demo today is sentiments, right? Sentiments on reviews. So you should now be able to ingest a reviews data, but also enrich it with sentiment analysis to be able to determine which reviews are negative, which reviews are positive, and you should be able to store that information as well in the index, which allows you to give you a richer search experience, because not only do you have the review text, but you also have the sentiment score associated with each of those reviews in the index now.
And so basically now you're not just indexing over what's in the actual document, but you can enrich it with any cognitive service?
Absolutely. So, right, so that's the whole objective, is you should not only be able to enrich it with any cognitive service, but you should be able to build a custom domain-specific skill as well that you might have. So most organizations have unique IP within their organization that deals with the data that they constantly see. And you should be able to take that IP, productionalize that as a skill, and make that available to your enrichment pipeline as well. That can then enrich your data with your skills in addition to cognitive skills.
So you're talking about skills, and I feel like you have like a process diagram here. Can you explain like how this process works?
Yeah, so if you think about it, you have data sitting in a data source. That data might look like either blob storage, SQL tables, you know, there's a whole host of options that you might store your data in. You should be able to take that data out of your data source with what we call an indexer. Think of an indexer as nothing more than a crawler that's able to reach into your data source, determine what's changed, and only index the information that's new or updated. And so the indexer takes that data, brings it into an enrichment pipeline. We have a notion of a skill set, which is essentially a collection of skills. Those collection of skills could be either cognitive skills or skills that you might build for yourself. And those skills are applied on the data as it's moving through this enrichment pipeline. And then at the end of the enrichment pipeline, you have what looks like this enriched document or this enrichment tree. And you can then shape that enrichment tree to match the schema of your index, as well as now we have a new feature called the Knowledge Store, which allows you to then project this information into the Knowledge Store as well.
I see. So before, what it would do is, because I remember running this on images, which blew my mind, right?
Right.
Because it actually put a label on the image. This is a giraffe. And you were able to search for giraffes and it brought up pictures. But now you're saying there's now an even a new feature that people can use that can project that data into a special place as well.
Exactly. Right. So if you think about it, you're going to be spending a lot of money enriching a lot of data if you're a large customer running this over a real scale environment. You may not necessarily have search as the only way you want to use this data.
I see.
So you might have other options for how you want to use this data, whether that be an in-app experience, whether that be for retraining your models, whether that be for training new models.
For anything, right?
So there's a number of scenarios where customers have come to us and said, it's great that we can do this, but how do I use the same data to retrain my models?
That's really cool.
Yeah.
So the data is basically like it's forking. You could use it for indexing, for searching, and you can use it for whatever other things you want. And that's the enrichment pipeline that's doing that.
Absolutely, right? The other thing to consider is the enrichment pipeline is a per document enrichment, right? So you are in a situation where each document that flows through the enrichment pipeline gets enriched using the skills that you have. But what if you want to do something that may be corpus-wide, right? TF-IDF might be a great right. example of one scenario like that, right? You might want to build a custom vocabulary. You might want to build custom word embeddings, right? So in those scenarios, you need skills that are able to act on the entire corpus of
That's
data
cool.
and not necessarily just on a per document basis. And the knowledge store allows you to essentially unlock those sets of capabilities as well.
Well, I feel like we've talked a lot about it, so I feel maybe you can show us how this works.
Absolutely. So let me switch to a quick demo. What we'll do is, we will start looking at the Azure portal. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk you through the process of taking some of the reviews data set that I just talked to you about.
Okay.
And then running that through the cognitive search pipeline, being able to use the knowledge store to be able to export that data.
Which is a new feature.
Which is a new feature,
Got it.
Right? And then what I'll switch to when I'm done is how easy it is to layer a Power BI interface on top of that to just be able to visualize that data and be able to explore it and just be able to catch a few critical insights. Basically.
And that's the Power BI over the knowledge store that we're now moving data to.
Absolutely.
Got it. Let's take a look.
Right. All right. So I've got data sitting in Blob Storage right now. So I'm going to click my import data workflow. And within my import data workflow, I'm going to create a new data source, which is going to be Blob Storage again.
And this is Azure Search, and this is pointing your index to a Blob Storage. Basically.
Exactly.
Okay.
So I'm going to be creating three assets here, right? So I'm going to be creating an indexer, I'm going to be creating a data source, and I'm going to be creating a skill set.
Got it.
And with those three assets, I'm going to sort of configure them to work with each other to be able to extract the data out of your data source, enrich it, and layer it into the index.
Got it. And so that when you're importing data, you're basically, this is where the stuff is.
Yeah.
The indexer is the worker, and then the indexer will push stuff into the knowledge store as well.
And the index, right?
Got
so
it.
So it's going to fork
Perfect.
It as you go along. So I'm going to call this the AI show data source. In this case, you can tell your indexers or your data sources, you know, what information you want out of them, right? So in this case, I still want the content and metadata. The metadata is things like which file is this in, and so you get all that information, the semantic information about where this data is stored.
Better to have more than less.
Exactly, right? So you know you could use it if you wanted to. If you didn't, you can always shape it.
Absolutely.
Right? In this case, parsing mode allows me to determine how I'm treating this file, right?
I see.
So the parsing mode, for example, if I was dealing with PDFs, I would leave it at default, right? And then it would extract all the text, all the images, and then it would allow you to act on those. In this case, I know I'm dealing with a delimited text file, so I'm just going to choose that.
And does it figure out, like, how to parse it correctly?
Yeah, so by the default parsing mode is a default, mm-hmm. and so essentially, I could still use default as a parsing mode for this particular file, but what that would result in is a cardinality challenge, right?
Got it.
So if you think about it, a CSV file with many rows is now going to get a single file in your data source is going to result in n number, as many rows as it has, mm-hmm. it is going to result in those many documents in your search index when I use a CSV file. If I use a default parsing mode, it's going to be cardinality of 1-to-1. Each document in my data source, I'm going to get
Smart.
One document in my index.
Cool.
All right, so in this case, I know my first line has headers. I know my delimiter is a comma. I'm going to choose a connection string to connect it to a storage account. And in this case, I am going to pick my knowledge store demo storage account. And I know I put my file in this container called
the AI show. We basically named it the AI show, so it would be at the top of
exactly.
all of the demos.
Exactly.
That's why.
That's perfect. I never thought of that, but that's a good idea. Right? All right. So at this point, it's doing a little bit of inferencing. So it actually opened up my file, looked at the schema, and validated that it can actually work with it, because that's what we do. Because in order for us to make some recommendations on the index schema, we need to be able to look at your data to be able to see like what sort of data are we dealing with, right? So the next step is essentially setting up my enrichment pipeline. So in this case, I'm going to attach a Cognitive Services account. The reason I need to do this is we support a free tier, which allows you to enrich up to 20 documents a day. But if you're trying to do anything more than 20 documents, you need a Cognitive Services key, mm-hmm. right? The Cognitive Services key is only used in cases where we are actually performing an enrichment for you using Cognitive Services.
Right.
But you still need to make it available for us to use if you have a data source, right?
And this is what would be called a skill.
This is exactly what we'd be using for a skill, right? The thing about it is, you know, we do a lot of work around, you know, how we are able to perform these enrichments for you in the most efficient manner possible, and we only charge you for enrichments that actually succeed. So you can't really call Cognitive Services by yourself at scale and be more efficient than we are for you.
Right.
So this is where I am actually going through the process of adding some enrichments to my enrichment pipeline, right? So I'm going to call this my AI show skill set. Now, if you notice here, it's actually looked at my file and it's determined what are the different you know, columns that are available for me to use, right? So I'm going to be selecting reviews text since that's the actual column that I want to be able to enrich. Then I'm going to determine, now at this point I can say, okay, I can use my reviews text completely, but then Cognitive Services also has limitations in terms of you know, the payload size that it can accept.
Right.
So if you're dealing with a really large file like you know, thousands and thousands of lines, you're going to have to chunk this up.
Okay.
Right? So this, we provide you the ability to split
and
chunk things up. Right. So in this case, since it's a review, I know it's going to be less than 5,000 character chunks. I'm just going to choose that. Right. And once I do that, I can now select what skills I actually want to run, right? So in this case, I'm going to do things like detecting sentiment, I'm going to detect language, and I'm also going to detect key phrases for now, right? So those I can also choose to do other things, but I think those are the ones that I really care about for this particular demo, right? Then the last thing I need to do now is determine how I want to project this information out into the knowledge store.
And this is the new part.
This is exactly the new part, right?
So
what the knowledge store comprises of is two sets of capabilities. You can either project it as tables or objects. Objects are nothing more than structured JSON.
Got it.
Right? But they're stored in Blob. Tables are stored in Azure Tables. Right? And both of these are scenarios that you could use. You could use either one or both. It really depends on how you plan to use the data.
That's cool.
Right? So now I'm going to choose an existing storage connection string. I will probably choose a new data set, enriched data, wherever.
And so this is, again, as you're looking for it, this is the direction that you're going to be sending the data, that's the enriched data.
Right.
Okay.
Exactly,
cool.
Right? So I've selected a Blob storage account. And now the portal experience for tables is, you know, we sort of look at your data and we determine, you know, what might be the different options that you might want to store.
Right.
Right? But this is essentially controlled through a skill called the Shaper skill, right? And this is one way that you could shape your data, but there's other ways that you might shape your data based on how you plan to use it. And so all you'd have to do is write a different Shaper skill that creates the data in a different shape, right?
I see.
It's that enriched tree of information is being projected into a specific shape before it's stored into the knowledge store.
Got it.
You control what that shape needs to look like.
And it's basically a shaping skill that forms part of that whole pipeline.
Right. So you can take different nodes of the tree, parent them under different objects, and then be able to create a new shape that says, okay, you know, I want my data to look in this shape.
That's cool.
Right. So in this case, I'm just going to select all of these options. And then the last thing I do is I customize my index. Again, this is basically looking at the schema of the file that I'm processing, mm-hmm. and then making some recommendations in terms of, like, you know, these are the fields that we could possibly use in the index, right?
That's cool.
And I'm going to accept most of the defaults here because you know, as you look at it,
it's pretty standard stuff,
right? So retrievable, for example, implies that, you know, when you perform a search, this particular row comes back, or this particular you know, column comes back.
Got it.
Similarly, filterable implies that you should be able to write a where clause sort of filter. Facetable implies that you get the facets on the on the, like, left nav that you know, it gives you counts of, like, how many each of these.
And listen, kids, I called it face table at one time.
Yeah, it's.
And then one of these smart people came and said, "Did you mean facetable?" I said, yes, I did. So
this is on us, right?
So
the naming is sort of like, when we think about it, we just imply it's facetable.
And it's like category. It's a way to do, like, tagging, more or less, right?
Exactly.
Got it.
Exactly.
Not a face table, kids.
Right. So at this point, I'm just going to hit next, create an indexer, you know, and then. So the indexer, again, is something that you can run on either a schedule or just one time. And it also has some interesting features in terms of, like, you know, how you manage errors, right? So, for example, you could set things like a max fail items to say, like, okay, if it failed at least on 5 documents,
that
I want you
problem.
To stop, right? So it's things like that. So at this point, I hit submit, my indexer runs, and now it goes through the process of actually looking at my data source, opening up that file, cracking it open, extracting the information out of it, running it through all the skills, and then performing the projections both for the index as well as the knowledge store.
And that's really cool because, I mean, this is obviously a one little file, but you may have thousands of log files
exactly.
that you can add skills to and then do some cool stuff.
Yeah.
So you mentioned that there was a Power BI that you used to build on top of that. What
yeah.
does that look like?
Yeah, so like any good cooking show, I actually ran this prior to coming in here. Mm-hmm. And I built this Power BI dashboard based on the data that I ran this through, right? And I ran this through, you can see that, for example, I ran it through about 35,000 records.
Which right? is the rows in that table.
Which is Got the rows it. In that file, right? Mm-hmm. You can see that, you know, there's simple things that I can get out of this that are just easy for me to comprehend, right? The other thing is building this dashboard is really easy because the other thing the knowledge store does is we maintain the relationship across the different tables that you project information into.
Okay.
So for example, you have a document that has key phrases and you project key phrases out as a second table. Now we're able to relate each of these key phrases back to the specific document that it came out of.
That's
right?
cool.
And so Power BI can just suck up that whole thing and then it just knows how to deal with these relationships. And then we're able to basically do all these filtering and sort of like selecting of information to be able to create these views based on all this data. Right?
That's cool.
And
now here's the thing. I've always found that whenever I run cognitive services over things, I find discrepancies between what people think is in the data and what the AI thinks is in the data. Yeah. Did we find anything like that here?
Yeah, absolutely, right? So like the first thing I'll show you is, you know, one of the things you see here is the count of countries one, right? Whereas if you look at the map, you can tell that there's data that's spread across geographically across different countries, right? And the reason for that is the reverse geocoding in the data set is incorrect, right? So the reverse geocoding always uses a US city and state. Mm-hmm. And so that's why when I look at the country code is always US, right?
I see.
So one of the things that we're doing now is in the next version of this demo, we're actually creating a custom skill that does the real reverse geocoding based on the latitude and longitude to put the actual values
Got
in
it.
There.
Got it. That's
right?
cool.
The second thing you'll notice is there is something weird going on now with the language code and the ratings or the reviews, right? So certain language codes are scored on a review scale of 10 versus certain language codes are scored on a review scale of 5. Right, so this is sort
That's a problem.
That's a problem,
yeah.
right? So now you've got to normalize this data.
Right.
And that's another thing that we're doing as part of that custom scale.
And that's kind of cool because you've actually gone through with minimal work, you've put something in, and you've learned a lot about your data within an hour, depending on how much stuff you've got in there.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is pretty cool.
Exactly, and not only your data, right? So we can do more interesting things with this, right? So I for example, I binned this information for the sentiment based on the sentiment score.
Mm-hmm.
So now I can do certain things, like for example, if I filter for airport, right? And if I look for all reviews that have a key phrase of airport associated with it, and I say, well, I want to really see like specific hotels around the airport, and I want to find all the ones that have a sentiment score of less than 20%, right? And if I do this, now you're going to see, and this is probably hard to read in the resolution that we're in right now, but if you look through a lot of these reviews, you're going to find that there's two things that'll stick out to you. The first is the two real indicators of negative sentiment at an airport hotel are either the breakfast or the bathrooms, right? And those are the only two things that really drive negative sentiment.
It's true. I've stayed at airport hotels and both the breakfast and the bathrooms were subpar. But this is cool because that sentiment score is not something that was in the original document. It's something that was added through cognitive skill sets inside of search.
Exactly. Both the sentiment score and the key phrases were things that were enriched as part of cognitive search.
Fantastic. So where can people go to find out more to close up?
Yeah, so the documentation page is definitely where I'd recommend that people look at in terms of saying, you know, how do they start using the knowledge store. There's a couple of things to look at there. There's the new Shaper skill that helps you use the knowledge store, as well as there's a getting started guide in terms of using the knowledge store. So they're both great places to start.
All right, thanks so much for all of that awesome information. Thanks so much for watching. If you want to find out more, go to aka.ms/knowledge store. You'll see all of the blogs and documentation, everything that he talked about. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next time. Take care.